In the previous segment of this series, Blumen's Angel of Apocalypsis was defined as one of the outstanding artworks of the entire 20th century. Indeed, while looking at the apocalyptic angel, the viewer may find in this multi-layered artistic image not only Filonov's approach discussed in the previous parts of the present series, but also Kustodiev's exuberant color bouquets, not only Kandinsky's abstract method, but synthetic cubism of Braque and Picasso, and finally, Larionov's optical experiments defined by the artist himself as Raeonism. However, if Filonov's every stroke was aimed at creating a tragic figurative image, while Kustodiev's paintings were a symbiosis of the traditions of Russian wanderers combined with Russian folk art. And if Kandinsky's abstract chromatic constructions, initiated through the combinations of whimsical geometric color formations, were giving to the viewer an opportunity to deliberate on his own mind on any preferred abstract concept, while techniques invented by Braque and Picasso during the period of synthetic cubism evoked a sense of dynamic reorganization of geometrical forms directly on the surface of the canvas. And finally, if Larionov's optical shapes enabled the viewer to literally witness by himself emerging energies of colors on the artist's canvas, Blumen's apocalyptic angel synthesizes all of the above in a totally innovative artistic form via animated contrasting colors, zones, interpenetrate into each other to become literally indivisible, so that as a result, a perfect artistic configuration full of abandoned metaphorical associations emerges just in front of the viewer's eyes. In this configuration, exceptional light color balancing is strengthened by the perfect arrangements of abstract elements intertwined with the figurative ones in such a way that a stunning multi-layered image appears before the viewer, which, however, is steadily determined to direct the viewer's perception by the creative will of the artist himself. And here it is. After a deafening first impression, ringing paints begin magically redistributing themselves on the surface of the paper background, literally in front of the viewer, as if the image's paints are led by an indivisible force, almost like in El Greco canvases. And so, all of a sudden, a monumental figure with widespread wings emerges from the polyphonic color scores. Of course, the title of Blumen's work suggests why the movement of this extraordinary soulless character is so dominantly powerful, and why the metaphorical color combinations are so strikingly expressive. On the other hand, the union of the pulsating color masses multiplied by animated biological semi-creatures seem to be inseparable from the hypnotizing stalactite landscape, which leads the viewer's gaze into a menacing bottomlessness ending somewhere on the horizon with a celestial color blue. In this kaleidoscopic image, not only in literal, but in the figurative sense as well, fear turns into an onslaught, wrath into energy. Chaos becomes a balancing structure, while a balanced structure is fraught with chaotic destruction. The artist himself suggests another reading of his artwork, according to which the angel of wrath touches the feet of the souls of sinners, which look like faded dead leaves on one hand, because on the other, the metaphorical crowd of sinners is forming some kind of the flowing living mass within which at one moment we can suddenly see the kernel outlines of human bodies, but at another moment an amalgamated plasma that simultaneously absorbs into itself or throws out someone's torsos, hands or heads. Or to put it in a different way, the torn body parts of the sinful corny souls blended into one gloomy fusion. In this apocalyptic world, the entire intermingled conglomerate of suffering sinners is guarded by the devilish phantasmagorical chimera, insidiously covered by the air bubbles filled with oxygen. Oxygen, which is apparently fervently desired by thousands of suffering sinful souls, but which doesn't exist in hell. What's more, accompanied by its surreal gloomy shadow, chimera of apocalypse will forever prevent this tormented mass from breaking through the hell's boundaries towards the gorgeous airy light of earth, since it is forbidden for doomed humans until the end of times. To conclude, Sergei Blumen's Apocalyptic Angel is a totally unique work of art which has no analogies either in the past or the present. As it was pointed out in the previous video lectures of the series, during his residing in Vienna, Sergei Blumen had solved several complex tasks equal to the tasks solved by the artist in his miniature metal sculptures. It is interesting that Blumen himself believes that his Venice series was aimed first of all at finding the new forms he was looking for while creating those sculptures. In reality, however, the Venice watercolors along with the oil paintings of that period marked the beginning of the development of Blumen's unique artistic idiom, which eventually not only creatively absorbed the countless artistic discoveries of the past, but revoked them into unique Blumen's style that made him one of the most outstanding painters of the 20th-21st centuries. What else to add to what was said above? For a year of his life in Vienna, Sergei took part in a musical competition in Germany, exhibited his work at several enameled and watercolor exhibitions, as a result of which an article on his metal artworks was published by the Frankfurt Art Journal in 1980. In the same 1980, shortly after arriving to the United States, Blumen received an invitation from Vienna to participate in an international teen symposium, where he created several innovative sculptures, namely Hanging Wedding, The Rider, and The Streetwalkers, for which he invented his own technology just during his symposium's participation. The symposium ended with the exhibition at the Vienna Museum of Contemporary Art, after which Blumen's work were acquired for the museum permanent collection. A month after the end of the teen symposium, Sergei Blumen participated in the World Conference on Applied Art of the 20th century, where he was invited by the World Craft Council as an honorary representative of the United States. Finally, in addition to all of the above, some of the artist's miniature sculptures created for his solo exhibition in the M. Graben Gallery, thanks to Inge Eisenbaum, as it was indicated again in the previous series, participated in the organized world tour around Europe, Australia and Japan from September 1981 to October 1982. And now it is the time to recall one more significant fact of Blumen's biography related to his life in Vienna. Between Blumen staying in Vienna during 1979 and his return to the Austrian capital in 1980, he spent half a year in Italy. That is how Sergei himself describes the beginning of his Italian period in his interview with Maya Pritzker on RTN in 2005.
Soon after my arrival to Rome, in 1979, I met the Count Andrei Volkonsky, a former director of Madrigal, a very famous musical ensemble in Russia during the 1960s, specialized in Baroque music. Andrei introduced me to his cousin Helen Volkonsky, and she acquainted me with the Countess Borghese, a sculptor and an ex-owner of the Villa Borghese. During the Easter service of Pope Paul II, the Countess purchased my artwork at the St. Peter's Square, which was very symbolic to me, especially because right after that she introduced me to the Duchess Bona Salviati, a heiress to the line of the family of Cosimo Medici, patrons of Michelangelo.
So, there in Italy, Blumen was given an exceptional opportunity to be invited by Bona Salviati into her household in Florence, where the artist worked on his oil paintings while traveling around Italian cities, including Rome, and studying the art of Italian Renaissance. Considering the chain of events happened to Sergei Blumen in Italy, it is quite tempting not to see in that chain some kind of a symbolic turn of fate, especially because in addition to everything described above, there in Italy, specifically in Florence, Sergei performed his last solo recital for trumpet by Giuseppe Tarelli with the Tuscan Symphony Orchestra. What's more, the concert took place in the front of frescoes by Cimabue in the Basilica of Santa Croce, where the world-famous musicians like Luciano Pavarotti and others performed as well. In the meantime, a totally new stage of Sergei Blumen's creative development began in New York, where he settled down in 1979. However, it was Vienna which turned the artist's life in a new direction and set the initial inertia for his growth as a painter. Therefore, in the conjunction with the latter statement, we should point out to the following important fact. In December 2000, a summarized review of the Applied Art of the 20th century appeared in the Austrian GZ Journal. The review listed dozens of names of the artists from different countries who exhibited their art in the Inge Eisenbaum Gallery. However, only Sergei Blumen was defined in that review as great, great Russian artist. Design Museum Zurich, the Eisenbaum Collection Jewelry of Our Own Times, GZ Journal, December 2000, Exhibitions, Eisenbaum Collections.